are you with India Post Live, India's first online news conversation web TV, where you too can participate in this conversation. I'm Ishan Russell. And how you can participate in this conversation, just simply go on to indiapostlive.com and go log in over there and post your comments. You can also come in via Skype or Google Hangout if you want to talk to our experts or participate in the conversation. You can also use Twitter, hashtag India Post Live to your tweets, or use our Twitter handle at India Post Live. So today we're talking about Narendra Modi and the rest. Yes, it almost seems that this election of 2014 has become a battle of Narendra Modi versus everybody else. Now, everybody else could mean a third front. That is what many Congress leaders have indicated. Third front leaders are saying that, yes, we could be in with a chance. So how really is this battle shaping up? We'll be discussing that today. First, let's take you through the story.
With most opinion polls predicting a clear victory for Narendra Modi-led BJP, the Congress is not averse to a post-poll alignment with secular parties to stop the Modi juggernaut. Several regional parties have expressed their opposition towards Modi, and this seems to have given Congress an option. But considering the blow-hot, blow-cold relation that the party shares with many regional satraps, it remains to be seen whether such a front could be a reality. Moreover, some of these regional leaders share a bonhomie with Modi. So would it all turn out to be Congress's wishful thinking?
All right, so to discuss this, we have in the studio Shehzad Poonawalla. He's a social activist and a Congress sympathizer and a member of the Congress party as well. And Matthew joins us. Matthew is a political analyst and an election researcher. And we'll also be joined by Paritosh Vyas of the BJP. He'll be joining us live from Gujarat, where he's the communication cell co-convener of the Bharatiya Janata Party. Shehzad, I'll start with you. As far as the entire subject of Modi versus the rest goes, it certainly seems that way, because the Congress is almost being relegated to the level of the other regional parties and satraps in terms of seats. That's just what even your own leadership seems to be indicating in the nervousness that they're showing about forming the next government.
First of all, I would like to tell you that the topic is absolutely well named, that it is Modi versus the rest. The reason why it is aptly named is because in 1930, there was a gentleman by the name of Mr. Hitler. And if you do realize, the entire world was against him. It was an ideological battle. Eventually, everyone was on the side of the right and Hitler wasn't on that side. And it is exactly the same battle that we are fighting today. So as far as the ideological battle is concerned, it has to be Mr. Modi versus the rest. Only Mr. Modi's vision can see a country where minorities have no space. Only Mr. Modi's vision can see a place where anybody who opposes him has to go to Pakistan. Only an arrogant Mr. Modi's vision can see...
But at the end of the day, Mr. Modi has been able to pick up allies along the way.
I'll tell you about the great stalwart allies. I come from Maharashtra. He's picked up a very important ally in the form of Ramdas Athawale, whose kul tally, the total tally that he brings to the BJP is 0 seats. The other important ally they picked up was Subramaniam Swamy. The number of seats he bought, 0. Mr. Ram Vilas Paswan bought one Rajya Sabha seat, which was given to him by Lalu Prasad Yadav. So I agree with you. These are extremely huge allies that he has picked up. I congratulate Mr. Modi for getting such big allies. But let me tell you, this statement that has come, this confusion that has come after Mr. Ahmed Patel's reported thing, which he has clarified in today's papers, that he did not say that he's supporting a third front. He said that, and the Congress's official stand is that third front is nothing but a myth. We continue to believe that UPA 3 will be formed. And what Mr. Ahmed Patel even said in his earlier interview, which got misinterpreted, was that we will speak to all like-minded parties to keep communal forces at bay. Pray I ask you, from after Rajiv Gandhi, there has not been a single party government. Any government has been a government that is a coalition one, and it is formed on talking to people who are like-minded. So how is that saying that we will form a third front government or we'll participate in
that? But it's all worked out to Modi's advantage, Matthew, at the end of the day, hasn't it? The fact that, the target for everybody is Narendra Modi, and therefore, in a contest where the BJP could be a number three in a particular seat, it's become number two. In a sense.
See, if you look at from the 1952 elections, the first Prime Minister of India, Jawaharlal Nehru, used to travel to every month he used to travel to one new city, and he used to communicate the government's and the party's position. And people used to listen to radios, and you know, the next day's newspapers would be full of the speeches of Jawaharlal Nehru. What has happened in this tenure of the UPA 1 and UPA 2 is the biggest problem that the UPA 1 and UPA 2 faced was the Prime Minister was not communicative. Although Pankaj Pachauri, the media advisor, would want us to believe that there were 1300 plus speeches of the Prime Minister. Why did the media not cover it? Either it lacked political punch. The political punch was missing. So, you know, the biggest problem of UPA is the lack of communication from the top. The Prime Minister has not spoken, Rahul Gandhi has not spoken, Sonia Gandhi has not spoken. So, obviously, in such a situation, what happens is, Narendra Modi, he has been assiduously cultivating the media. In fact, he has been pressurizing the media. The social media is full of, you know, Narendra Modi and his bhakts. So, in such a situation, Narendra Modi stands out. He stands out, and because of the lack of...
Isn't it advantages for a politician, say like Mamata Banerjee, who's trying to get the Muslim vote in West Bengal, or for a party like the Samajwadi Party, or for even that matter, the BSP, to almost vilify Modi so that the polarization is going both ways and it's helping both, perhaps not only the Congress?
Would you like to take that?
Yeah. See, the polarization is happening across, especially in North and West India. And Modi is trying to have a pan-Hindu, pan-India consolidation across the country. And to some extent, it is definitely succeeding. Now, you know, polarization, try and understand 85-15, you know, 85-15 kind of a ratio, it will never succeed if secular forces try to play the Muslim card. Except for Bengal, which has about 30% Muslim minority, most other places about 15-20%. So, you know, it will be not in the fitness of things if secular forces play the Muslim card.
All right, we have Paritosh Vyas of the BJP now joining us. He's the co-convener of the BJP's communication cell. Thanks very much for coming in, Paritosh.
Yeah, finally. Thank you.
We're talking about how your prime ministerial candidate has really become something that every other party is fighting against. And in this election, we expected a multi-cornered battle, but it's become Modi versus the rest. What would you say to that?
It's always been Modi versus the rest, I would say that. Right from the time when the elections were declared, and even before that, if you see, it was always Modi bashing from the east, from the north, from the south, and from the west, everywhere. So it always was Modi versus the rest, and they didn't have any other topic apart from Modi.
All right,
I just want to say that he's, like I said, I agree that it is Modi versus the rest because of the ideological plan. What Mr. Paritosh should also be wondering is that it is not Modi versus the rest in the country, it is Modi versus the rest in his own party. Even Mr. Advani, Rajnath Singh, RSS, stalwarts of RSS, they give statements in the press and they say that we are scared if 200 seats are there, then we will have somebody else pushed as the candidate. So even their party is against Mr. Modi as much as the rest of the people, and that is primarily because the kind of ideological positioning that Mr. Modi brings, somewhere I think even the BJP people know that it is not healthy for this country and will lead to a very divisive narrative in this country. So it is only on an ideological front. Otherwise, the kind of politics that he plays per se, I don't think that the secular liberal person in this country and the tolerant Hindu that is in this country appreciates it any more than the secular liberal Muslim. So I think the larger community of secular liberal people don't appreciate the kind of politics.
There are many nationalists in the BJP who would not want Mr. Modi to be Prime Minister. I mean, and the biggest fear in the RSS is that he might just break the party. So, you know, if he's not made the Prime Minister, one of the biggest fears that the RSS faces is the challenge of Modi. If he crosses 200 and is not made the Prime Minister, then he may break the party. I mean, my personal feeling is that the RSS will make an upper caste, either Rajnath Singh or Nitin Gadkari as their Prime Ministerial candidate. They are just using Modi as bait.
Paritosh, would you like to counter that?
When I was a kid, I used to read Around the World in 80 Days, and there was a line in that, very famous line, don't jump to conclusions or conclusions may jump on you. I'm feeling that my fellow panelists are jumping to conclusions too much. It's category in BJP number one. You had a point when you said that Advani ji or Rajnath ji or some other leaders are talking about Modi ji. I believe BJP is the only party in India, where there is an inner democracy, where people have a right to say. It is not like Mulayamji's party or anybody else's party, or where Sonia Madam speaks and the other people keep shut. So we have a party where we talk. There's no doubt about that, number one. Number two, it could be a personal presumption that the liberal Hindu, the so-called liberal Hindu, doesn't like Modi. Then what will happen when the results come and we get 200 plus, 250 plus seats? In that case, what happens? Do we get dubbed as communal in that case? No, we don't.
Well, I would just like to say that, yes, they have so much inner party democracy that Mr. Jaswant Singh was sent out of the party packing. And I would like to remind Paritosh that is he willing, as a member of the BJP, to say that if they do not cross the 272 mark, and if they do not get the required, the NDA does not get the required numbers, and they have to build an alliance, they will consider any other candidate other than Mr. Modi?
I'll let you respond to that, but if you just could tilt your camera a little down, we get,
is any member of the BJP willing to say that if in case we have to form new alliances to make reach the majority mark, we will also consider making anybody else other than Mr. Modi the prime ministerial candidate?
But that is not required. See, we are forming a government on our own strength. And there is no doubt about
I'm
that.
I'm talking
and
to you about one, an eventuality
number
that
one,
may be very possible.
One. Number two, if you look at the coalition politics right from 1998 onwards, it's always been a trend that whichever the party passes the post first, there is a line behind to support that party from the other parties. It's been a trend in 98, 96, 2000, 2004, 2009. So I am not very sure of what you are trying to do.
That I also agree with.
The very fact that he is not denying it, the very fact that he is saying that we will not reconsider anybody else becoming prime ministerial candidate itself means that they are not sure and they are not.
Did I say that, or you are putting words in my mouth?
Why don't you then say that if we get less than 272, we will sit in the opposition? Say that.
We are very clear on one position, that our prime ministerial candidate is Mr. Narendra Modi and nobody else.
So, in case you don't get the numbers, you'll sit in opposition.
No,
we will get the numbers.
I agree with Mr. Vyas that bahut sare log surrender ho jayenge if BJP crosses 200. Certainly indicate that they're not very confident of the Congress doing well in this election. And even
on
the
what
Congress,
basis you say that?
The basis of Sharad Pawar's statement.
What did he say?
Sharad Pawar had said that, if I remember correctly, what did he say?
You don't remember it, the ploy?
I remember there was a news item saying that something to the effect that Congress might not do that well in this election.
For that we have to wait till 16th May unless
Paritosh has the nervousness of your own allies you can't deny, can you?
There's a difference between the BJP overconfidence and arrogance, which says that we have won the elections even before the results
are
out.
And the Congress resigning to its
And
state.
The Congress has always, whether it was 2004, whether it was 2009, he's been a political trend watcher. Please tell me one time that the Congress has gone out chest thumping, saying 56 in chest, 272 mark, we are winning, we are forming next government for next 30 years. Has the Congress ever spoken in this arrogant fashion?
They have not.
But it's a point to be remembered that this country has always chosen the Congress and has shown the BJP's place.
But they have not. But unfortunately, in 2014, the Congress has completely given up the battle. They have completely surrendered. They are not putting up a fight. At least the SP and BSP in UP is putting up a fight. The TMC and the CPM is putting up a fight in Bengal. But the Congress has completely surrendered. They have already...
And in Gujarat, they are nowhere.
Okay. If we are nowhere, the BJP is taking candidates from Congress party, giving them tickets. Those candidates who abused the BJP till yesterday are being overnight given tickets.
But that's the
We ourselves are not giving these guys tickets. They are giving them tickets and they are bringing them on and making them fight elections.
Politics.
Whether it is the likes of Jagdambika Pal, whether it's Satpal Maharaj, they claim they have a wave. Now, if it's a wave,
but
your prime ministerial candidate, one second, is contesting from two
but
seats.
Strong candidates
and not
from your party are leaving your party and going over to the other side.
So there's a lot of people who have come from Vajpayee's niece has also come to Congress party. Why do you forget that?
That is the nature of the beast.
So the point is that there are enough number of candidates going to and fro. But my point is that if these people are in a wave, you have a chief minister, you have a prime ministerial candidate contesting from two seats, not leaving his chief minister post. You have the party president leaving his current seat, going to another seat. You have them giving tickets to other party people overnight and asking them to win an election for them. I mean, this is the kind of wave, this is the kind of confidence. And just because there is a perception in the media, and you all know why that perception is, just because of the perception, are you going to say that the Congress is not going to do well? Then please look at 2004 and 2009. I request you to
look
at what
happened. The fact is Salman Khurshid, Jairam Ramesh, Ahmed Patel, you're denying. But the fact is that they've all said that a secular front should be looked at, a third front. The Congress could support,
No. Their statement is to be interpreted in the manner in which Rahul Gandhi and Ahmed Patel and Sonia Gandhi, the top three of our party, have put it, that we always talk to all political parties. It's a coalition front government that will be ultimately formed. Even BJP says that. We talk to all parties to hammer out an agenda, and that accordingly will be the agenda that will come to power. So we will talk to other parties. Even BJP will do that. So there's nothing wrong with that. That does not mean we are going to support a third front. We do not believe that there is space for a third front. We do not believe there'll be a BJP-led government or a Congress-led government. That's it.
All right. But Paritosh, I also want to put this to you. As far as the politics of polarization goes, that is really benefiting you. What Narendra Modi has managed to do in this election is, of course, make it Narendra Modi versus the rest. And the polarization that has happened as a result is certainly benefiting the BJP in this election.
Tell me one thing. When everybody, it's not, as you are saying, it's Narendra Modi versus the rest have decided to take him out. Everybody is taking him on. So when everybody is doing that, it automatically translates into polarization. That's what we are trying to tell you. They don't have any agenda. They don't have any other thing apart from Modi, Modi and Modi. So people are watching, people are listening, people are reading. So they understand this.
The reason why the agendas look like it is Modi versus the rest is not because the other parties are targeting Modi. They're targeting his ideology. Why it has become, why it seems Modi versus the rest is because Modi goes around saying, Ab ki bar Modi Sarkar. Is that our slogan? The BJP president, when he puts Ab ki bar BJP Sarkar, within half an hour he changes it and puts Ab ki bar Modi Sarkar. Their own leaders are frightful, and Advani ji says in a letter that I am, saddened by the way one personality is being promoted. Their own party leaders are uncomfortable with the thought. They do not remove a manifesto until the first phase of elections has begun. Their leaders say it's not manifesto, it's Modifesto. They are the ones who are promoting one person as the solution for everything. They are saying leave policy, leave ideology, leave country. There is only one solution, Modi. And then they say that why it is Modi versus the rest. They must ask themselves that question. They are the ones who are trying to play on the personality of one individual. And the reaction is to the ideology of that individual. See what he has done in 2002. And I again reiterate, yes, last time when it was one man versus the rest, it was Hitler versus the rest. And this time also it is one man versus the rest. It is Moditva versus the rest. And it will be that way because you represent the ideology of a divisive India where minorities and other people who oppose you cannot exist.
Go ahead, Paritosh.
See, what I was trying to tell you is very simple. You compare anybody with anybody. That doesn't make any difference. Now, just because you don't have a person whose name can be promoted, Rahul Gandhi, for example, if I'll say, then Rahul Gandhi has failed on all fronts. He doesn't inspire. So that's why perhaps that's the reason why you've not promoted him as a prime ministerial candidate. Now, that is your internal matter. What we do is our internal matter. If we wish to promote Modi ji as a prime ministerial candidate, I mean, you should take it up. There's nothing wrong with that.
The reason why we do not need to rely on personalities is because we're fighting an election in 543 constituencies on the basis of our policies. We are not in the American system, which you think we may be. You don't have any policy answers. No, we had the primaries to select a candidate on the basis of what grassroots want. They did not do that. And if you are confident about your policies and your ideologies and your work, have you asked the people to vote for you on your work? No, your ads, your every propaganda material says vote for us because Modi will come to power. So it shows a bankruptcy of ideas on your part. Please, we live in India where the prime minister is formed after all parties come to power. We vote for parties and ideologies.
Absolutely. We'll see Narendra Modi as the prime minister on the 16th.
That's
no worries.
You have nothing to say on policy.
All right, so you guys stay on your stated position with Matthew bringing you into this conversation. And also, just before I come to you, all you viewers, if you want to participate in this conversation, use Twitter, hashtag IndiaPostLive to your tweets, or use our Twitter handle, at IndiaPostLive, or just go to IndiaPostLive.com, log in and post your comments, or come in via Skype and ask our experts questions. Matthew, talking about the rabid political attack that has now become the nature of this political campaign, especially in the latter part of this election. Do you see this continuing? Do you see this as a trend that regional satraps who think that the Congress is on very weak footing might be able to gain in more states, might be able to become larger personalities, and therefore taking on Modi is proving to be advantageous to all, be it Mamata or be it Jayalalitha?
See, without doubt, the certain sense of civility in political discourse has been lowered by all political parties, but the trend was set by, regrettably, Arvind Kejriwal in the 2011-2012 phase, and then Narendra Modi, and then followed by everybody else. See, the level of discourse does not behove a parliamentary, does not behove what should be in a parliamentary election. This is almost like a corporator level discourse. The discourse that is happening.
No, I want to just ask that what stellar standards of discourse was the prime ministerial candidate of the Bharatiya Janata Party setting when he said that there are three AKs from Pakistan, AK-47, AK Antony, who is a defense minister even now, and candidate of a party who was a chief minister of Delhi, former chief minister of Delhi. If somebody was to say that Mr. Modi comes from Pakistan or Mr. Modi comes from some other place, I mean, he's, after all, Arvind has been a chief minister. He's been a constitutional authority. So for their prime ministerial candidate to lower the level of discourse is fine. But anyone else says anything, that's taboo.
All right, that's still an allegation, Paritosh. I know you're counter to that already.
How is so an allegation he made in a public statement?
In the sense that you're alleging that the prime ministerial candidate is like that. But Matthew, still, the question is unanswered, that the regional star troops are finding power in a weakened through a weakened Congress, they're being able to take on Modi and then get a larger stature.
Whether it is the SP, whether it is the TMC, whether it is the left.
Are they really gaining in terms of on the ground? Are they really gaining at the expense of the Congress?
In Uttar Pradesh, the fight is between the SP and BSP versus the BJP. Hmm. It's not Congress will be relegated to the fourth position. Similarly, in Bengal, it is the TMC and the left who is in the fight. In Simandra, for example, it will be TDP and Jagan. So Congress will be wiped out. So the Congress is, 2014 Congress has not put up a good fight as I would have wanted it to be. Is the regional parties definitely are putting up a very strong fight. They are putting in money, muscle, resources, everything. And so is the BJP.
Enough to break the Modi wave? Or the so-called media dubbed Modi wave?
See, the Modi wave is at a subterranean level. It is not, does not have depth. It has width, it does not have depth.
I can assure you that in the states of UP and Bihar, BJP and its allies will not cross 30 seats. I'm talking about both UP Bihar, which is 120 seats. I'm writing it down today that it will not cross 30 seats. The Congress RJD alliance in Bihar and the Congress in UP will be higher than the BJP alliance in UP Bihar. Mark my words. And I'm here. I'll be back on 16th May.
Absolutely.
The Congress RJD alliance will do much better than the BJP. That I agree.
I'm saying UP Bihar. We will be much higher
than them. You've been traveling across these states. In fact, across the country. What is your assessment? I'm sure it's Mission 272. But in terms of real ground strength, ground support, how are you faring?
You're asking me?
Yes.
Okay, sorry, I was not able to hear the last part. Anyway, it's Mission 272 and we are targeting 300 seats along with the NDA, number one. Number two, as far as my friend told that what happened in, what is to happen in Bihar and you.
Well, we seem to have lost the audio connection with Paritosh over there. We'll just try to get back to him. But Shahzad, as far as the Congress goes, the fact that I think after the Gujarat election of 2000, the one where the Mothka Sadagar won the statement. 2007. And after that election, the Congress really did not decide to take on Modi. I mean, it chose to ignore him to a large extent. And therefore, now you're in a situation where, he's become larger larger than life figure even for the Congress.
See,
to deal
I
with.
Will tell you one thing. Our Gujarat Congress has always been highlighting several issues like Mr. Modi's intolerance towards free media. He's banned free media in Gujarat Assembly. The 1 lakh crore worth corruption scandals, Adani scams. We did a Gujarat Vikas Khoj Yatra. Now, yeah, why the media did not cover it and give it the traction that it gave Arvind's visit to Gujarat, that's a question for the media to answer. But we were constantly at this entire of agenda of trying to show what is the real face of Gujarat and under Mr. Modi. As far as this election is concerned, they have chosen to make him prime ministerial candidate. There is no constitutional precedent for it in India. They have chosen to say, Ab ki baar Modi Sarkar, there is no constitutional precedent for something like that in India. They project a personality. They want to play on a personality. And then when somebody questions the personality for his policy initiatives, we say that this guy is about decentralization. He holds 12 ministries, contesting from 2 seats, does not leave this chief minister post. Then we become ones who are targeting a personality. So pray, how are we supposed to fight an election? If we don't, they say it's a prime ministerial candidate. If we don't question his performance, then how do we question them? How do we expose them? So please, that is our strategy. And we are against the ideology of Modi. Modi is dispensable. Moditva is what we are fighting.
So Moditva is a new terminology that the BJP, is it comfortable with the Moditva ideology, Paritosh?
Have you heard any of our leaders talking about that particular word? No.
Ask
I mean,
Mr.
if
Advani.
Congress chooses to invent new words, they are welcome to that. And
Advani
for the next 20 years, when we see Modi as the Prime Minister, I'm sure Congress is going to go to sleep for a long, long time. Perhaps like Rip Van Winkle.
I understand that your confidence is coming from the fact that you spent a long time in opposition, about 60 years, each year trying to say that Congress is a corrupt party, each year trying to say that Congress Mukt Bharat. Their 2004 manifesto, coincidentally, also has a page dedicated to Congress Mukt Bharat. They've been saying it from the time they were born as Jansang and Hindu Mahasabha. They've been saying it till now. They'll continue to say it in the future. Best of luck with that. But what you have to see is that you need to fight elections on the basis of principles, on the basis of policies and ideologies, which you don't have. Therefore, your reliance on Modi.
But that reliance on Modi means that his policy or his idea, I mean, that really becomes, it is finding a little bit of purchase on the ground, isn't it, Matthew?
Definitely in certain middle class sections of the, at least urban India, and especially among the youth in rural India, it is finding traction. So Modi is, because he is a, what is that, snake oil charmer. He's selling snake oil. So that is what he is selling. So he is selling something which is new and which is alluring to these people, this cohort of voters.
All right. On that note, gentlemen, I'll have to wrap up because we'll completely run out of time. I'll give you final statements. Shahzad, we'll start with you.
Well, as Matthew rightly put it, there is an allure, there is a charm surrounding the personality of Mr. Modi, which is very low on policies and issues and ideologies. And that kind of charm surrounded, that kind of allure coincidentally also surrounded the advent of Mr. Hitler. The world got united to fight Mr. Hitler. If people do want to get united to fight the ideas that Mr. Modi brings onto the table, that is, his opponents should go to Pakistan, there should be no space for Hindus, Muslims to live in Hindu areas, then I think it's a good thing that we all unite against this Moditva. As far as fighting Modi is concerned, they made him a personality, they made him the prime ministerial candidate. Our strategy is just to point out the holes in his policies, and if they are so offended by that, they need to go and check with themselves. I mean, that's not our problem.
Paritosh, final statement.
Very simple. I can hear Shahzad screaming his head off at the moment. I know he's worried. The next 20 years are ours. So perhaps 16th will be the best time to come back again and then discuss whether Modi ji, as a prime minister, will really work hard and make India truly great. See, Congress has already looted the country for the last 10 years, and everybody knows that. So I don't have to comment on that. So my point is very simple, that policies, ideologies, everything is firmly in place. Once we form the government, we'll let you know of that. Thank you.
All right, on that note, we'll wrap up. 16th May, of course, both of you are welcome and invited over here. And so is Matthew, of course, will be our resident expert analyzing the election live for us. So that will be a special coverage for the elections on India Post Live. Thanks very much for coming in, Shehzad, Paritosh, and Matthew. Well, on indiapostlive.com, you can go in and log in, watch this discussion, participate, give your comments. And while you're there, you can check out a really cool game that we have. It's called the Vote Race. You can go there and play that game. You can play as Arvind Kejriwal, Rahul Gandhi or Narendra Modi, and you have to go and collect as many votes as possible while you're at it over there. So that is Rahul Gandhi driving his little van trying to collect as many votes as possible. You can go try your luck over there, try to contribute to this election if you want. If you've already voted, well, here's a chance to grab a few more votes. On that note, we'll wrap up, but conversations continue right here on India Post Live.